So this is vector session number 9 for us. So today we will begin with the understanding of three dimensional components, because we've already got used to application of component algebra in two dimensions, and now we can move ahead in that part and understand the general three-dimensional representation, and then after that few more things. So we'll start with component representation of vectors in three-dimensional system. Or you can say component in 3D. So to understand this, first of all, let's visualize a three-dimensional coordinate frame, or what is called a Cartesian system of coordinate axes. So Cartesian, or sometimes is also called rectangular. Coordinate frame, but three-dimensional type. So it consists of three mutually perpendicular axes. So you have to be able to visualize this diagram as if it is three-dimensional, and this pair of axes x and y are perpendicular to each other, this pair of axes y and z are perpendicular, and this pair of axes x and z are perpendicular. So it consists of three mutually perpendicular axes. Mutually perpendicular XYZ axis. Okay, so basically X axis is perpendicular to Y axis, while at the same time it is also perpendicular to Z axis. Okay, and Y and Z axis are also mutually perpendicular. So you can see here that they form three two-dimensional planes which are also mutually perpendicular. So here the xz plane, you can visualize this like the floor of the room in which you are sitting, and the xy plane, you can visualize it as the wall that you are seeing in front of you. So you can see that these two are mutually perpendicular, this plane and this plane, and you can visualize the yz plane as the wall which is on your side. Let's say on the left hand side of where you're sitting, you see one wall. You see one wall in front of you, one wall on your side, and the floor on which you're sitting. So these three are mutually perpendicular planes. So the same way the XYZ system forms three mutually perpendicular planes. So they also form XY, YZ, and ZX planes, which are mutually perpendicular. So this is the system of axes called the rectangular coordinate frame, or the three-dimensional system. Yes, so just make a note of this first. So once we understand the Cartesian or the rectangular three-dimensional coordinate frame, next we can see how to represent a vector in the three-dimensional form. So whenever we say things are mutually perpendicular, means that they are perpendicular to each other in pairs. So when we say that the three axes are forming three pairs of planes, XY plane, YZ plane and ZX planes, so each of these planes is perpendicular to the other. That is what is meant by mutually perpendicular. Like the floor is perpendicular to the front wall is perpendicular to the side wall, and the side wall is again perpendicular to the floor. So these three planes form a system of mutually perpendicular planes. So like that, the XY, YZ and ZX planes also form a system of mutually perpendicular planes. Okay, so hope this is clear. Now, once we define the three coordinate axes, and accordingly we have the system of mutually perpendicular planes, for vector algebra in this kind of system, we will define one more unit vector. So, the base unit vectors in a 3D system, these will consist of, we already have the I cap and J cap, that remains the same. But along with that, we have a third one now, K cap, which is the unit vector along the positive Z axis. Okay, this is as usual along the Y axis. And this is along the x-axis. So this forms a system of, again, these are mutually perpendicular unit vectors. Because they are in mutually perpendicular directions. So again here, I cap, J cap and K cap would form a system of three unit vectors which are such that any one vector is perpendicular to the other one. So this angle is 90 degrees. This angle is 90 degrees. This angle is 90 degrees. And they are all of magnitude 1. They have unit magnitude. Z axis. K cap is along the Z axis. You can write Z like this, or you can write Z like this also. The last letter of the English alphabet, that is Z. That depends on how we are viewing it, no? So if you are if you are looking into the XY plane such that your x-axis is pointing towards your right, no? So suppose you're looking into your front wall and the x-axis is pointing horizontally towards the right, whereas the y-axis is vertical. So in that case, z-axis will be taken coming out of the plane. So here, if this is x and y, then in this one, the z-axis, the positive Z axis, that is coming straight out, okay, perpendicular to the XY plane. Okay, but if you view the same thing from the other side, it will be going into the plane. So if you view it from that other side, you go to the opposite side of the wall and view it. This is your X axis, this is your Y axis. So here Z axis will be going into the plane. Okay. But you know, that is something else. We will discuss that in more detail later when we come to something called cross products. So we will see that there is something called right hand rule, very similar to Fleming's left hand rule that we had studied in ninth probably when we did electromagnetism. So this thing only when we visualize this in 3D, it becomes like this. So the z-axis is coming out from the side where you are looking into the xy plane like this. So if you are looking straight into the xy plane, like the z-axis is coming out. Is it clear at home? So there is a certain convention that we follow to understand whether z-axis is coming out or going into the plane. And that convention also I will be discussing soon with you, but that will come in cross products of vectors. So right now it is enough to understand that they are mutually perpendicular. That's the main thing. Okay. So now representation of any vector in three-dimensional component form. Will be represented like this. You'll have some x component, some y component, and along with that, now it has the third component, the z component. Okay, so, in this ax, ay, and az, they are just scalars. Okay. They can be positive, negative or even zero, okay. But they are scalars, okay, and they are respectively called the x component of the vector A. Similarly, this is the y component of the vector A, and this is called the z component of the vector A. So, for example, if we have a vector like this, excuse me guys, 2i cap plus 2j cap plus k cap, let's say. So, this is a vector where the x component is plus 2, the y component is plus 2, and the z component is plus 1. Okay. If we have a vector like this, which is minus 3 I cap plus 4 k cap. So here you can see the x component is minus 3, the y component is 0, so that's why the j cap term is missing, and the z component is plus 4. So accordingly, the components x component, y component and z component, they are just scalar quantities which can be either positive, negative or even 0. Now, given a vector with its components, how do we visualize it? Let's understand visualization of the three-dimensional vector. So, let's do that visualization with this example only. Okay. So, for this example, how to visualize this vector? So, you know, the thing is, we have to imagine this because we are drawing the diagram in a two-dimensional plane, but at the same time we have to be able to visualize it as something three-dimensional. Okay. So the thing is, if you visualize your system of axes like this, okay. So this is your origin. Okay. Now think of a point over here which is having coordinates 2, 0, 0. So now you can see that if I draw a vector like this, if I draw a vector joining the origin with the point A, that vector is nothing but it is 2i cap, because I have taken this as my x axis, this is my y axis, this is my z axis. Okay. Now similarly here, now if I visualize another point on the y axis, which is at the coordinate 0, 2, 0, and now you likewise visualize another vector, but this time joining O with B. So that vector now represents what? A vector of magnitude 2 along the positive y axis. So if this point was B, then this vector now represents 2 j cap. And likewise, you must have guessed by now that we define some point on the z axis, which is 0, 0, 1, because the z component is 1. So next, if we draw a vector joining the origin of our system with this one, so let's say this point is C, so the vector OC in my diagram is 2k cap. So now in comparison to this, see what is our vector A. Our vector A is the sum of these three things. It is 2i cap plus 2j cap plus 2k, sorry, plus k cap. Again and again I'm making this mistake. It's just one unit. Okay, so this is this. So just k cap. Okay. So now it's basically like the sum of three displacements like this. This is a displacement of 2 units along the x-axis, 2 units along the y-axis. So if we sum these up, what would that resultant thing mean? So let's understand that next. So next, when we are summing this up, you again start by visualizing the xyz system. So to begin with, my xyz system is the mutually perpendicular axis. Now starting from the origin, I want to do this operation. I want to add the three individual vectors that we had understood. Which were OA, OB and OC. Okay, so I have these also there as guidelines. Okay. So you can understand that OA as a vector is 2i cap. OB as a vector is 2j cap, OC as a vector is k cap. But now I want to do a different operation. I want to do the operation 2i cap plus 2j cap plus k cap. So how will that operation look like? Okay, so let's understand that. So let's start with the operation of OA or 2i cap. So starting from the origin, if I make a displacement of 2i cap, I will reach this kind of a point here. So this vector over here is my 2i cap. But now from here, I have to make a displacement of 2j cap, because I'm adding 2j cap to 2i cap. So instead of OB, what I'll do is I'll draw a vector here parallel to OB, but starting from the point A. So how will that vector look like now? So that vector will look like this one. From here, this will be my vector. I will have a line which is parallel to the y-axis, okay, and of identical as OB. So this will be my 2j cap. Okay. So on completing this, let's say I will reach another point now, some other displacement point, which is D. So the coordinates of this point will become what? They will become 2, 2, 0. And this is in the xy plane only. And then to that, what I'm doing, I'm adding another vector k cap. So k cap would be a vector of magnitude 1. Okay, but in which direction? Along the z axis. So from here, I would go like this, parallel to the z axis. And I would reach some point like this, k cap. And I would finally reach some point, let's say, E, and this point would have coordinates 2, 2, 1. So this would be my final position. So the vector sum of 2i cap plus 2j cap plus 2k cap is basically what? This vector is the vector OE, because I have gone OA plus A to C, sorry, A to D, okay, and then this is D to E. So the final displacement is what? It's OE. So in the diagram, you can understand the final displacement is basically the, so just to understand this better, what we'll do next is we will first think like we have drawn a three-dimensional figure like this. This sort of a figure. A cuboid sort of a figure. Which has sides of length and two legs. Okay. So my vector OA is a side of length 2 along the x-axis. Then A to D is a vector of 2 units but along the positive y-axis. And finally my DE is again a displacement of unit length 1 but along the z-axis. So the sum of these three is becoming the vector OE, which is 2i cap plus 2j cap plus k cap. So that is my vector E. So my vector A in this diagram will finally become which one? My vector A in this diagram will become this diagonal. It will become what is called the body diagonal because it's cutting through the three-dimensional thing. That is my vector A. So what is the geometrical interpretation of this vector? It is the body diagonal. Okay. Of a cuboid of sides 2, 2 and 1 in this case, but in general AX, AY and AZ. So this is basically my, in my particular diagram, this is the AX side, the side parallel to the X axis. This is the AY side, the side parallel to the Y axis. And this is the AZ side parallel to the Z axis. So if I draw a cuboid of side lengths AX, AY and AZ, then the body diagonal starting from the origin, which is one of the vertices, to the, you know, body opposite of that, that becomes the vector, which is the sum of AX I cap plus AY J cap plus AZ K cap. Just a minute, you were asking the question, Om, that OA is parallel to OD. No, the answer is OA is not parallel to OD, because if you've seen just the XY plane alone, no? If you just look at this from the front now, forget about the Z axis, this is your origin, this is the point A and this is the point D, no? So it's not parallel. AD is parallel to OB, but OD and OA are different. OD is like the hypotenuse of this, this is 2 and 2. Like this. BD, yeah, BD is parallel, correct. So BD you can see is this, no? So BD is the same vector as OA. No? So the vector OA is the same as the vector if we drew BD. And all these other sides, if you name them also, there's nothing but 2i cap. Similarly, the vector OB is the same as the vector AD, which is 2j cap. And likewise, my vector OC, which I drawn originally, is the same as this vector DE, which I drawn now in this diagram, this k cap. So the geometrical interpretation of this type of vector, AX I cap plus AY j cap plus AZ k cap, is like you draw a cuboid which has mutually perpendicular sides, AX, AY and AZ. And then you draw the body diagonal of that cuboid. So that particular vector that you're getting from one corner of the cuboid to the opposite vertex through the body, that one is nothing but your resultant vector. This is the best way to visualize a three-dimensional vector. Okay, so hope this is clear. So I'll just zoom out a little bit from this. You can see it with the caption. So actually, first to compare these two figures, then you can come down to the part below.
Why the change?
Okay, now next thing, magnitude of the vector. Okay. Yes, Itanchu, this part. Or further up.
Okay. So next thing we look at is the magnitude of a vector expressed in component form. It has a magnitude equal to square root of ax square plus ay square plus az square. And this follows from the simple logic that if a cuboid has sides a, b, and c, then the diagonal, that is the body diagonal, has a length of root of a square plus b square plus c square. This is very simple result from geometry. This is like a extended application of Pythagoras theorem. So basically from that only this comes. So if you imagine draw a cuboid now like this. So we have these kind of points, and the vector that we are talking about is the sum of the three components. It's going to be nothing but this body diagonal, let's say this one. So this is having the length L, let's say, whereas say the sides have lengths A, B, and C. So we want to find L. So what we do is, first of all, you understand this in-between one. You see, it's a right-angled triangle. In this, you visualize that triangle OAD, okay, angle AD, sorry, angle OAD is equal to 90 degrees. So therefore, OD square is equal to OA square plus AD square. So we can say OD is square root of A square plus B square. This is our first equation. Okay. And next, what you do is you visualize, now visualize triangle ODE. Now in this, you can see OD is in XY plane, because you're taking this OA as your X axis, you're taking OB as your Y axis, you're taking OC as your Z axis. So this is your Z axis, this is your X axis, this is your Y axis. Okay. And DE is along Z axis. So that means what is happening? Again, angle ODE is equal to 90 degrees. It might not be so evident in the diagram, but if you just try to visualize the diagram from this side, you'll realize that yahan pe ye jo angle hai, the angle between this line OD and this line DE, this is a 90 degree angle. Because OD is lying in the XY plane and DE is along the Z axis, perpendicular to it. Alright, so hope this point is clear. So therefore, what will happen in this triangle? Again, applying Pythagoras theorem, OE is the hypotenuse. So that will be equal to OD square plus DE square. And D is nothing but the same as C. And this thing we saw from here is this plus this. So therefore, L is square root of A square plus B square plus C square. This is a simple geometrical proof using the two right angle triangles. So that geometrical proof now translates to this, because here what we are doing is AX I cap is nothing but the vector OA. AY J cap is nothing but the vector OB. And AZ K cap is nothing but the vector OC. So the vector A is nothing but OE. So the magnitude of the vector A is nothing but L. Like so. So from that we get that magnitude of A is square root of AX square plus AY square plus AZ square. So that is the correlation between these. Alright, so that's the proof and the concept of magnitude of a three-dimensional vector. Okay. Next, when it comes to addition and subtraction, it's very simple again. The sum of two vectors will simply become the sum of their x components times I cap plus the sum of their y components, and along with this now there's a third z components also. So sum of their z components to k cap. And likewise, if there had been a minus sign here, then we just put a minus sign over. Okay. So for example, suppose we have now I ask you to find A plus B minus C. Okay. And the magnitude of the same thing, A plus B minus C. So this is just like doing normal algebraic operations, but just you will be taking the unit vectors common. Okay. So what will happen here is
because we are adding the two vectors a and b and then subtracting the vector c, this will become the sum of a and b's x components, but sorry, minus c's x component. ऐसा हो जाएगा माइनस सी एक्स आई कैप. ओके देन सिमिलरली सेम ऑपरेशन विद द वाई कॉम्पोनेंट्स ए वाई प्लस बी वाई माइनस सी इज वाई कॉम्पोनेंट एंड देन सेम विद द जेड ए जेड प्लस बी जेड माइनस सी जेड की कैप. सो नाउ यू जस्ट सब्स्टिट्यूट दीज थिंग्स सो यू कैन सी दिस इज वन वन एंड वन सो वन प्लस 2 minus 1. Okay. Then the y components slightly different now. You can see this is 2 plus of minus 1 minus of 0. C has a z component, y component which is 0. So this j cap component, then the z term will be 1 plus 3 minus 2. Okay. So this overall now becomes 2i cap, okay, plus j cap or 1 into j cap, so that's j cap, okay, and plus again 4 minus 2, so that's 2 k cap. So this is becoming our vector a plus b minus c. This vector is becoming this. So now, so that's the first part. The second thing, we want to find mod of a plus b minus c. So that is nothing but magnitude of this vector 2i cap plus j cap plus 2k cap. So that is nothing but magnitude of or square root of the x component square plus the y component square plus the z component square. So that you will see is 3. We will never write this as plus minus 3, mind you, okay, because it is square root of 9 and not plus minus of square root 9. So the magnitude of a plus b plus c, sorry, a plus b minus c, my mistake, is 3. The second. Whereas the vector itself in component form is this. Okay, so please make a note of this example. And through this, any operation to do with addition, subtraction of three-dimensional vectors, you can easily solve this way. See, it's own, that's basically mathematics. See, if I say that x square is equal to 4, so that means x square minus 4 is 0. So that means x square minus 2 square is 0. So that means x minus 2 into x plus 2 is 0. So that means x can be 2 or x can be minus 2. Okay, that's one thing. But if I say x is equal to square root of 4, this means only one thing, x is equal to 2. Okay, or if I say x is equal to minus of root 4, this means only one thing, x is equal to minus 2. So these are separate cases. You understanding? So that is the complete, you know, algebra kind of explanation of this. Here too there is no problem about it because you know that it's magnitude of a vector. Magnitude of a vector does not have algebraic sign. It's not negative or positive. It's just a magnitude. Component of a vector can be negative, but magnitude of a vector can never be negative or positive. Like we can say that the displacement has a horizontal component of or a component along the x-axis of plus 2 or minus 5 or something. But we can't say the displacement is of magnitude plus 2 or magnitude minus 5. The displacement is of magnitude just that amount without any sign.
Okay. So let's understand this kind of algebra, including the visualization, with a question now, where we will learn how to use this, three-dimensional vector components in an actual situation. So let's do this. Okay. So a man first walks, let's say, 1200 meters towards east. Okay. Then after that, he runs another 1500 meters at 37 degrees north of east direction. Okay. And finally, he climbs a vertical ladder, the type of ladder you will see, dangling along a pole, or a straight, ladder that goes up to a tank or something like this. So it is not a staircase, it's a straight vertical ladder like this, with gravity like this. It's not a staircase where the direction of displacement is like this. It's not this. This is a ladder which goes vertically upwards. So as a vertical ladder, he climbs through a displacement of, let us say, 300 meters. Okay. So find the magnitude of his net displacement. That is a question over here. Just try this out. Yeah, similar type of question one. Okay. But this time I want you to do this by using three-dimensional component form. Okay, so let's go through this question. So let's try to understand how we can use a three-dimensional coordinate system to represent this system of displacements or this set of displacements. So let's say what we do is that we define our horizontal plane as the xy plane with the x-axis going from west to east as usual and the y-axis going from south to north. So the xy plane is the horizontal plane, okay, such that these are my geographical directions. So now in this kind of system we would see that we were to try and draw a three-dimensional kind of situation. Now see that if this is a horizontal plane, then a vertical axis would be the one which is cutting this perpendicularly. So it would be like this. This would be perpendicular to this plane. So this would be a z axis, okay, which is vertical. So in this diagram, it's coming out of the plane in the first one. But in the second one, you can see it like this. And in the second one, your xy axis would now be represented like this. This would be your XY system. So this is a system of mutually perpendicular axis. You can see like this. So now coming back to my question. So what is happening? The first displacement is 1200 meters towards the east direction. So that would be represented like this. This is how you would represent the first of the three displacements. This is 1200 meters. So let's say this is my displacement E. So the displacement E would be written as 1200 I cap in meters. Okay. Now in the same figure, my second displacement would show up as a vector, which is like this. It's 1500 meters. At 37 degrees north of east. So this would be my second displacement B, let's say. Okay. So that second displacement would be B's x component would become 1500 cos 37. So that would be 1200, and B's y component would be 1500 sine 37. So that would be 900. So this would be 1200 I cap plus 900 j cap in meters. Okay. And now my third displacement is the vertical one. Now that I cannot show in the first diagram because it's coming out of the plane, but in the second diagram I can easily show it because it is a displacement which would look like this. It would be vertically upwards, so it would be along this direction. This would be my third displacement C, which is 300 meters. This one is the displacement C. K cap, like this it would be. Again in meters. Okay.
Whereas in this same diagram, you can see that your displacement A would have been like this, and your displacement B. Somewhere like this, but in this plane. Okay, so now the net displacement is the sum of these three. So we'll just use vector algebra, component vector algebra. So the net displacement is the vector sum of A, B, and C. So that is becoming 12 + 12 = 2400 I cap plus 900 J cap plus 300 k cap. So we can write the magnitude of the net displacement as square root of 2400 square plus 900 square plus 300 square. So we can even simplify this by taking 300 common. So we have 8 square plus 3 square plus 1 square. Okay. So that is becoming 300 root 64 plus 9 plus 1. So that's 74. Okay. So this would be our magnitude of the net displacement, which we can further approximate and write as root 74 would be approximately 8.6. So that into 300. Approximately 'll just minimize this a little more, but through this you should understand the application of three-dimensional component system. When we have three-dimensional displacements or motion in three dimensions, this is what it looks like.
Okay, so hope this question is fully clear, this example. So this is about component algebra in three dimensions. Okay, now moving ahead, we come to the absolute last part of vectors, where we'll be discussing the product type of operations for vectors. So this is going to be something new for us, because we haven't discussed any type of vector products yet. What we've discussed in terms of vector algebra is sum and difference of vectors, and we learned how to calculate sum and difference using both geometrical representation as well as component representation. And today we learned the component representation in three dimensions, which is the most general case. Now moving ahead to more types of vector operations. So the next operation we will see is what is called dot product. Of two vectors. Okay. Now another name for this is, you also call this the scalar product. Okay, so this is also referred to as scalar product of two vectors. So the symbol used for this operation is basically a dot. That is why it is called dot product. And the definition of this operation is that when we operate two vectors with this dot product operation, it is calculated by magnitude of A multiplied by magnitude of B multiplied by cos of the angle between them. This is the definition. So the scalar product of two vectors is calculated by the multiplication of three things: the magnitude of the vector A, the magnitude of the vector B, and cosine or cos of the angle between A and B. Okay, this is the definition of dot product. Okay. So as a simple example, suppose we have two vectors A and B like this. Where the vector A is of magnitude 10, the vector B is of magnitude 8, and the angle between them is, let us say, 60 degrees. So here, in this example, the dot product will be 10 into 8 into cos of 60. So it will become 32. Sorry, 40. Like this. So just make a note of this definition. No, there is, so we will come to that when we will understand that we cannot calculate dot product of three vectors. Dot product is always calculated for two vectors. So when we understand few of the properties here, we will understand how that happens. So just make a note of the definition and the first example, then we'll come to that. Okay, so with this definition understood, now let us talk about the key properties.
Exactly. So that's why you can see it's not possible. So with the definition in mind now, let us understand some of the properties of dot product. So given that we define A dot B as AB cos theta, first thing we'll understand is A dot B is a scalar quantity. Okay, and the reason for this is you can see the right hand side is the product of three scalars. Okay. This is because AB cos theta, it is the product of three scalars, magnitude of vector A, magnitude of vector B, and cos theta. So that's the reason why it is called scalar product also. Now within that you can also understand such that A dot B is positive if theta is an acute angle. Okay. A dot B is zero if theta is equal to 90 degrees, and A dot B becomes a negative quantity if theta is an obtuse angle. So you can see that, for example, if A is, let us say, a force of 50 newtons towards east and B is a displacement of 20 meters at 60 degrees north of west. Okay. And we want to find out A dot B. Okay, so see here, just try this out. After writing down this note, just try to figure this out. What is your question? Whom I didn't understand, just explain again. A has both magnitude and direction, no? So it's a vector, no? B is also having magnitude and direction, so it's a vector. No, A is a force, no? Which is towards east and of magnitude 50 newtons. So you can understand that if we represent A over here by a vector arrow, you could draw it towards the east direction. So magnitude 50 newtons, but it's pointing towards east. Okay. In comparison to this, the vector B will be of magnitude 20 meters. It's a displacement of magnitude 20 meters, but it is in a different direction. So that would be like this now. This is what it would look like. This would be my vector B as a displacement of 20 meters, but it's this direction, 60 degrees like this. So what would be the angle between A and B now? The angle would be 120 degrees. So A dot B being AB cos theta would become magnitude of A is 50 newtons. Magnitude of B is 20 meters, but into cos 120 degrees. And as you know, cos 120 is the same thing as minus cos 60. The same thing as minus half. So this would be 50 into 20 into minus half in Newton meters. And you know, Newton meters has the same unit as energy or work done, which is joules. So this would work out to be minus 500 joules. Unit would be joules, because 1 newton meter is 1 joule. So this would be A dot B. It would be a negative quantity here, because the two vectors A and B are at an obtuse angle. So it is a scalar quantity ना बेटा. तो जो final result मुझे मिल रहा है वो तो scalar है ना. That minus 500 joules is a scalar quantity. A and B are vectors. The dot product of them is giving me a scalar quantity. Don't get confused. Okay, A is a vector, B is a vector, but what we are getting by the operation A dot B, that quantity is the scalar. Is it clear, Om? We can know its product, that's why. In fact, that is how we define work done. In a later chapter, you will see that the scalar product of force and displacement is actually the work done by a force. We cannot add two quantities of same of different units, but we can always take product. Just like in normal algebra, na, you cannot add a length with a mass, but you can always multiply density into volume gives you mass. Mass divided by volume gives you density, things like that. Mass into acceleration gives you force, but you cannot add a force with a displacement like that. How did we take theta as 120? Because 120 is 180 minus 60. The direction of the displacement, the second vector B, was given to us like this. It is 60 degrees north of west. So this angle was given to us as 60 degrees. Okay? And the direction of the first vector was given to us towards the east. So this angle is this much.
Okay. Now next important property of dot product we'll see. Dot product of any vector with itself is square of its magnitude, and likewise whereas because so this is the next property of dot product. No, A and B have to be vectors, beta. अरे we cannot define dot product of a scalar with a vector. ऐसा कुछ operation ही नहीं होता है. This is not correct. Okay. Or this is not correct. Not defined. Dot product has to be operated on two vectors. But what it gives us is a scalar quantity. If I am taking dot product of a scalar with a vector, what is the meaning of angle theta? The scalar doesn't have any direction only, no? So I don't know why unnecessarily you are confusing yourself. Okay. It is there in the definition only, no? That A and B are vectors. It is the result of the operation, the A dot B value, which is a scalar. Yeah, obviously, no, it's defined that way. That is what we have written down also, no? That the dot product of A and B is a scalar quantity. It can be a positive scalar, it can be a negative scalar, it can be zero even, but it's a scalar. Make a note of this quickly. Next point after this is that A dot B is the same thing as B dot A. So dot product is what we call commutative, like addition for example, or multiplication for example. Like that, dot product is also a commutative operation. It doesn't matter what order we take in it, whether we are doing dot product of A with B or of B with A. It's just product of the magnitudes into cos of the angle. Okay, so hope you are clear with these two properties. Now next
property of dot product is something called the distributive property. That is, A dot of B plus C can be calculated as A dot B plus A dot C. This is called the distributive property. Okay, so these three properties are collectively very important because we make use of them. Yeah, we make use of them. Distributive property, commutative property, and the property that you've seen earlier, that dot product of a vector with itself is square of its magnitude. And using that, you get the dot products of the unit vectors. Yeah, Hitanshu, just write down the property. Yeah? There's nothing more to it. Just write down the property number 4 the way I've written it down and label it as distributive property. There's nothing else to explain in this. Okay. Now next thing, we'll see dot product in component form. So for example, if I have a vector A which is 4i cap, and I have a vector B which is 2i cap plus j cap, and I want to calculate A dot B, so what I can do here is I can just use the properties which I had written earlier. This thing's dot product I want to do with 2i cap plus j cap. So I can write this as 4i cap dot product with 2i cap. Okay. And add that with 4i cap dot product with j cap. Okay. And now I can make use of the properties that I had seen earlier, that I cap dot I cap is 1, whereas I cap dot j cap is 0, because they are mutually perpendicular vectors. So this becomes 8, this becomes 0. So that is your A dot B. Okay. So now, like we have done this operation, we can generalize this by using the same properties for any two vectors. So the general formula will become like this. If the vector A is having the three components Ax I cap plus Ay j cap plus Az k cap, and the vector B is having the components Bx I cap,
by j cap and bz k cap, then the operation a dot b will simply be given by ax into bx plus ay into by plus az into bz. Okay. And this again happens because of this, the combination of these two properties, the distributive property which we have seen earlier, okay, and along with that this unit vector properties, that I dot I is 1, j dot j is 1, k dot k is 1, and I dot j is 0, j dot k is 0, and k dot I is 0. So if you use a combination of this property and these formulae over here, you can see how this formula comes. So this is the general formula for dot product in component form. Just make a note of this, people. Okay. No.
So, you know, basically this comes by just directly applying the product. If you open this bracket, you will see that you will get 9 terms in all. No? You will get ex, bx, I cap dot I cap, but ex, by, I cap dot j cap, then az, bz, sorry, ex, bz, I cap dot k cap. Now, out of these three, for example, you can see that this is 0, this is 0, but this is 1. Okay. Like that, you will get more terms, 9 terms in all. So when you see all the cross terms, I dot j, I dot k, or k dot I, etc., they're all zero. So you're left with just this. So that is the simple logic of this formula. So for example, if I have a vector and I want to calculate . So here I'll just apply this formula. E dot B will become the product of I cap terms, so that is 1 into 0, plus the product of J cap terms, that is 1 into 1, plus the product of the Z components, so that is 2 into 3. So in this case it becomes 7. Okay, so E dot B becomes 7. Okay, so hope this question is clear to you people. Let's work out a couple of more questions. So next example, in a two-dimensional plane or in a two-dimensional XY system, vectors A and B are shown to us like this. Find A dot B using the geometrical formula. Secondly, by component method. Just try this out, people. So anybody got the answer? So if you go by the geometrical method, you can see that the vector E is having a magnitude of 50. The vector B is having a magnitude of 40. And what about the angle between them? This angle, ये कितना है? दिस थीटा इज 53 डिग्रीज. सो बाय ज्योमेट्रिकल मेथड इट्स ए बी कॉस थीटा. सो इट इज 50 इंटू 40 इंटू कॉस ऑफ 53 डिग्रीज. सो इट इज 50 इंटू 40 इंटू 3/5. ओके, सो दैट्स हाउ मच नाउ 1200. So this is your A dot B. Yes, that's correct. Okay. Now, if we are doing this by component form, we'll have to first break A and B in component notation. So the vector E will be such that
magnitude of A is 50 and angle is 37 degrees with respect to x-axis.
Okay.
So the x component is 50 cos 37, so that is 40, and the y component is 50 sin 37, so that's 30. So the vector A in component form can be written as 40 I cap plus 30 j cap. Okay, and the vector B in component form you can directly see is 40 j cap. Okay, so A dot B, general formula, AX BX plus AY BY. Here AZ is anyway not there because it's two dimensional, so it doesn't even matter. And just write it as this much only, but the complete formula is this. So this is becoming 0 plus 1200 plus 0. So it's the same. Okay, so hope this is clear by both the methods. Okay, with this we can conclude today's session. Tomorrow we'll learn more about applications of dot product and then the final part of vector algebra. So that's it for today's class, people.